everybody. Welcome to Extension Monthly. I'm Jennifer Davidson, the County Coordinator with Alabama Cooperative Extension here in Russell County in beautiful Phoenix City. And today we are able to, we're lucky to get David Kuhn, our regional agent, who is a specialist in home grounds, to talk with us a little bit about pruning, which this is the best time of the year for most of our pruning, although not all, and he'll cover that. And so we are really thankful to John's Lawn and Garden to let us come here and shoot this on site. So there's a couple of upcoming events I wanted to mention to you here in Russell County. Before we get going, on January 26th, if you're interested in having show calves, we are doing our first livestock program with our 4-H club, with our 4-H program here in Russell County. And that meeting, the introductory meeting to that livestock program, is January the 26th at 5 o'clock at the Russell County Extension office. And then also wanted to make sure that y'all know every year we participate in Arbor Day, and this year Arbor Day is going to be Saturday, February 18th. It's going to start at 10 o'clock and we're going to give away all those wonderful free seedlings that we give away every year at the Idle Hour Moon Lake Pavilion. If you have any questions about these or any other upcoming extension events, please feel free to give us a call. Our office is at 334-298-6845. And thanks so much for watching. Stay tuned so you can watch David talk about how to prune your favorite ornamentals. So David, one of the most common questions is, when do I prune and which plants do I prune at what time? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, that's a real common question we get. And there's a real simple rule. It's called the May rule. And it's a good way for you to know when to time your pruning. And the May rule simply says, if a plant blooms before May, I'm going to prune it after it blooms. And if it blooms after May, I'm going to prune it first thing in the spring. And what we're doing is determining when the flower or when the plant puts on that bud, that flowering bud. If it blooms before May, it's blooming on what we call old wood. An azalea is a good example of an old wood bloomer. Mm. The buds for those azalea flowers are on that plant all late summer, all winter, and they bloom in the spring. So if we prune that old wood bloomer, that azalea, first thing in the spring before it blooms, we're actually pruning off those flower buds.
But it won't kill the plant, right? So if somebody really needs to cut back some azaleas, it won't kill the plant.
Correct. And when we do a renewal pruning, regardless of when it blooms, mm-hmm. we're going to do that first thing in the spring anyway. So if it blooms before May, I'm going to wait till after it blooms. Now, if it blooms after May, that's a new wood bloomer. A crepe myrtle is a good example of a new wood bloomer. It's putting on a flush of growth in the spring and then forming those flower buds to flower on that new growth. So we can prune those plants early in the spring and then have that new growth come and put those flower buds on. Now, the thing about timing that, and mm-hmm. as we're sitting here January the 17th in Alabama, and it's 78 degrees, is timing that, well, when is winter over and new growth begins in the spring? And the thing you have to really be careful about when we get these warm spells and you get antsy to go out and prune, and you'll do some pruning, that plant kind of thinks it's spring.
Yeah, oh, I've got a lot of new growth coming on right now.
Anytime we mm-hmm. prune, we're stimulating new growth. Mm-hmm. So we're removing that terminal bud, we're allowing that plant some new growth, a flush of growth. So if we prune it now in this nice little warm spell.
Yeah, you're probably going to get a nice flush.
You're going to get some growth, and then in 2 weeks when we have that 25 degree weather again, you're going to get some freeze damage on that nice tender new growth. Mm-hmm. So the textbook answer is, I want to prune that plant after the last frost.
Who knows when that is, right?
Before new growth begins. And that's extremely hard to time. So right. You want to wait late winter.
Right.
When you think all of the cold weather is gone, but before new growth begins.
I've always thought it should be January or February, again with our crazy weather. Maybe February would be the better bet.
Late January, February, early March is your best bet on most of your old wood bloomers.
Right.
Now your new wood bloomers.
So for anything that blooms in the spring, what I think of during that spring flush of all those beautiful forsythia, azalea, what's the one with the prickles, the pink, anything that blooms in the spring, you want to prune it right after it blooms.
Correct.
Unless you're not concerned about the blooms, and in that case,
that's right. If it's a hedge, if it's an azalea that's gotten out of control and it's too big, and you're having to prune it back, you want to do that renewal pruning. Cut it back to 14 inches or so in the spring before new growth begins.
Very good. All right. Well, so you've told us a little bit about timing on pruning. So will you show us a little bit about the tools that you use to prune?
Okay. There's a couple of things I look for when I want to choose a pruning tool. And there's a couple of basic tools we'll use. The first one is a pair of hand pruners. And this works up to stuff about as big as your thumb. And a general rule of thumb is, if you have to winch on it or use extra effort to cut on it, you probably need a bigger tool. So if it doesn't cut it freely and easily with the size tool you have, you need to move up to the next one. But when I look at pruning tools, there's a couple of things that I want to look for. One, I want good sturdy handles. I want handles that are attached and aren't going to bend and move. I want to look for a tool that's got a good hooked blade. So when I put that on that piece of wood, it kind of grabs it and holds it. So when I make that cutting, it makes a good clean flush cut. The next thing I want to look for generally on any of my larger pruning tools is a pair of bypass pruners. And you see the blade here bypasses the bottom jaw. That's why we call it a bypass pruner. You can also get an anvil type that has a solid bottom, and that blade comes down in the middle of that anvil, but it tends to mash when it cuts larger things. So I always want to look for that bypass pruner. Good handles. I want a spring-loaded pair of hand pruners, so when I make that cut, it opens nice and easy. And I also want to look for something that locks closed, so that when I'm through pruning, I can close it up and there's no danger to me as I'm moving around. It's always good to have a good scabbard, something to hold your tool, so as you're moving about in the garden or in your lawn, you can store it right there on your belt. You've got your bigger pruners in your hand, you're moving about, you've got all your tools with you. Prevents you from getting somewhere and using the wrong tool because you left it at the last plant. It also prevents me from taking my hand pruners and sticking them in my back pocket, so when I bend over, I cut myself or cut my clothing. It's just a nice, secure way to hold it, and it's a lot safer. You'll also notice that I'm wearing safety glasses, which I would recommend anytime we're doing any kind of pruning, because it's very easy for plants as you're moving about inside them and pruning to do some damage to your eyes and poke your eyes. So always have a good pair of safety glasses on as you're doing your pruning. Now, when we step up from a hand pruner, we're gonna go to what we call a lopper, and it's a little bigger tool. Again, I'm gonna look for those good solid handles, metal handles that aren't gonna bend. I'm gonna look for that bypass blade, that hooked lower jaw that helps me hold that plant. I also like to look for a replaceable blade on these larger tools. A good quality pair of loppers or hand pruners will cost you $40 or $50, but they'll last a lifetime. These have been through 15 years with the Extension Office, multiple pruning demonstrations, and have held up real well. But if the blade happens to get damaged or bent, I can simply replace that blade at a much lower cost and keep the tool. Another thing I want to look for is some good quality bumpers in between those handles, so when I'm making that cut, I'm not mashing my knuckles together with that tool. So when I get to items that my hand pruners can't prune, I go to my loppers, and that'll go up to about a little smaller than your wrist maybe. But when it gets bigger than that, the next tool I want to move up to is a nice little handsaw. And you'll notice this saw has a scabbard, just like my hand loppers. So I can put that scabbard on my belt, carry it around with me. When I'm not using it, it simply goes in there and can be stored. These saws cut both on a pull and a push motion, and they cut very easily through most of your wood. So when you get above a size that cuts cleanly with a lopper, you need to go to a nice little hand saw, and it'll make your job much easier.
The Optical Shop. Enjoy the view.
Pampered is every day at Newsom's Tax and Accounting. Family owned and operated since 1996. They've provided individuals and businesses with stress-free tax preparation. Plus, they offer referral fees and repeat customer discounts to all their tax clients. Dependable, accredited, and honest. Always working to get you the most from your return. Open year-round for accounting, payroll, business consulting, incorporation, and every need in between. Always pampering. Newsom's Tax and Accounting, Phoenix City.
Jen, we've talked a little bit about old wood bloomers and new wood bloomers and the May rule and when we want to time our pruning. So let's talk a little bit about functioning of pruning and what we're trying to accomplish when we do prune. We said earlier that when we make a pruning cut, we're stimulating growth. So we always need to keep in mind wherever we make that cut, down below that cut, we're going to stimulate a flush of growth. So if we look at these two camellias right here, you see a couple of different styles that come to mind. This camellia right here has been pruned in this pot to be more of a tree, shrub type specimen. And so we've got not a lot of leafy growth at the bottom, but more of a tree specimen type growth. This camellia, you see, has a lot more lower growth and it's a little more shrubbier. And so it's been pruned a little different way. But you'll notice we've got some runners coming out the top that we might not like. So anytime we think about pruning these to keep the form of what we want, we always want to look and come back here to a growing point to decide where we're gonna make a pruning cut. So if I make a pruning cut right here on a limb that's growing inside, I'm gonna stimulate growth to the inside of the plant, which I probably don't want. I want some more lateral growth, lower bushier growth. So I'm gonna come right here to this lateral branch that's going out and make my pruning cut to keep this lower growing form on this camellia. Same thing on this side. I'm just looking, coming to a growing point, seeing where I want to direct that growth to go to make that pruning cut. Again, always make your pruning cut at a growing point. If I make a pruning cut in the middle of that node right there, I'm not going to get any growth till I get down here to these buds. So I'm leaving this stob sticking out, this unsightly, promotes disease as it decays and other things. So I'd always want to come back right there to that growing point to make my pruning cut. So here we've reduced the height of this camellia a little bit. Probably want to come in, take a few more of these stragglers out, clean it up just a little bit, and keep my lower growing form and shape. So now we've got much more of a bushier shrub type camellia. And as we look at this camellia, we can see the tree form that it's kind of forming and growing. And what I want to look at on a camellia is I always want some open space in it. I don't like a crowded center. It needs some air movement. It helps prevent disease and other issues. So I'm going to come in probably and take one of these center pieces out. And try to help open it up a little bit so when it grows it's got air movement and it's got it can dry and we don't have those disease problems when we do that. And that's about all I would do with this camellia, as it's more of a tree form and we're trying to get a little more vertical growth out of it. So let's move over here and look at this cryptomeria. This plant is a real good replacement for your Leland cypress in your landscape that's got a lot of disease problems now. But it's a real good example of what we need to look for when we walk up to a plant to start pruning. The first things we need to prune out of a plant when we walk up are any dead, diseased, or broken plants, parts of that plant. We want to go ahead and prune those out because it just promotes any dead or diseased things, promotes disease down the road, and it's just easier to remove those first and see what we have left. So if we looked at this cryptomeria, we see we've got some disease portions in it down here. I'm just going to go ahead and remove these out. And on most of our evergreens, we're not going to do a lot of heavy pruning other than to remove these dead, diseased, broken pieces out of the plant. So as you go through and clean it up and try to remove those dead and diseased portions, it'll be a healthier plant down the road and provide you a lot better use. All right, let's move over here and look at a couple of roses here in pots and see how they've been pruned and what we got going on. And if you look at these two roses, similar size, you notice this rose was pruned back real early this winter. And we talked earlier about pruning too soon and having a flush of growth and winter damage. And if you look at this rose, you'll see some of the winter damage that occurred after pruning. So it was pruned a little early. It's going to have winter damage anyway, but after that damage occurs, we need to come in here and go ahead and remove those damaged pieces. Again, so we're keeping it from having disease problems or rot problems on that plant. So we're just going to clean it up. If you happen to prune too early and got a little freeze damage, that's all you need to do to clean it up. Now this rose, you see, was not pruned early. This is the form we want it to look like in the end. So just a good example of where we would come back, put those canes to about 12 to 14 inches, avoiding the stickers. And we got some damaged, diseased portion right here we're going to prune out. And now we're ready to put that plant in the landscape. And that's about the pruning we would want to do on most of our roses. Again, wait till late winter, early spring before new growth begins. Cut those roses back to 14 inches or so, picking out four or five big canes. If we leave too many canes, especially with a rose, it'll try to put too many flowers on and you end up with a lot of small flowers instead of the larger showy flowers. So the fewer canes, the more energy it can put into those canes and the bigger, showier flowers those canes can produce. So that's a little bit about on roses. Let's talk a little bit about kind of a popular plant that's popping up in a lot of our landscapes. And we talk about edible landscaping and some fruit we can have at home. And this is just a bramble, a blackberry. And something a lot of people don't realize on a blackberry is it's a two-year bloomer. So it puts on a flush of growth 1 year. That growth kind of just sits there and doesn't produce anything. And then the next year, that growth will produce fruit. So this is a one-year-old growth of this blackberry. It will produce fruit this year. After it produces fruit, those canes will die and new canes will come up from the bottom while it's doing that. We want to remove these after they die and leave that new growth because it's going to produce the next year. So it's a two-year rotation on our blackberries and our brambles to produce. So if we're pruning them all the way back to the ground every year, we're not going to get any fruit because we're not leaving that first-year growth, which will produce fruit the second year.
I want to thank John's Lawn and Garden for letting us do our show here today. We are so thankful to have such a wonderful mom-and-pop garden center here in Phoenix City. And I want to thank my special guest, David Kuhn, who is our regional agent with Alabama Cooperative Extension, for talking to us about all that good pruning information. So thank you for being here, David.
It's a pleasure to be here, Jennifer.
I want to thank y'all on behalf of the Russell County Extension Office for watching Extension Monthly. We'll see you next time.